सो हेलो गाइस, वेलकम टू शून्य आईएएस। सो वी आर अगेन हियर डिस्कसिंग द प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चंस ऑफ सीसैट एंड द टॉपिक फॉर टुडे इज अगेन स्पीड डिस्टेंस एंड टाइम। एज आई टोल्ड यू यस्टरडे, इट इज अ गुड टॉपिक, इट इज एन इम्पॉर्टेंट टॉपिक एंड इट इज ऑल्सो अ लार्ज टॉपिक एंड देयरफॉर यू नो वन वीडियो इज नॉट इनफ। सो वी आर कवरिंग दिस टॉपिक इन टू पार्ट्स एंड देयरफॉर दिस इज द सेकेंड पार्ट फॉर आवर डिस्कशन फॉर स्पीड डिस्टेंस एंड टाइम। ओके, सो वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट सम आइडियाज यस्टरडे in the previous video of speed, distance and time. Those were the basic idea of speed is nothing but distance upon time. That is the concept we are going to apply in each and every question. Apart from it, we studied the idea of relative motion. Now, what is relative motion? When two bodies are moving, we have the idea of relative speed. So, when they are moving in opposite direction, their speeds are adding up, and when they are moving in same direction, their speeds are actually subtracted to get the relative speed. That was the idea we discussed in the last video. And now we'll build up on the same concepts we discussed yesterday and look towards some more questions now. So, welcome guys. This is a sneak peek of our online course, and here we have comprehensively covered speed, distance and time topic. So, you know guys, it is very important to have a proper optimized solution for every problem of yours, and we have this as the best solution available for the market in old Rajendra Nagar and throughout the country, I guess. Okay, so without further ado, we'll begin our discussion. So look at this question now. A train travels a certain average speed for a distance of 63 kilometers and then travels the distance of 72 kilometer at an average speed of 6 kilometer per hour more than the original speed. Okay, so the scenario is given. Let me just draw a diagram, a rough diagram, so that you can actually grasp the situation. So there is some train going from place A to B, and there is some place C in between. This distance from A to C is, let's say, 63 kilometer, and the further distance is 72 kilometer, right? Now the speed of the train is given. Here the speed of the train is coming out to be how much? We do not know the value of the speed. So let us assume the speed to be what? Let us assume the speed to be s. And in the second case, the speed now is 6 km per hour more than the original speed. So here the speed is going to be s plus 6 km per hour, right? What next? It says that it takes 3 hours to complete the total journey, which means the total journey from A to B, the time taken will be, so T total is nothing but 3 hours, right? So what is the original speed of the train in kilometer per hour? So we have to find this value of S, and the units are given to be in kilometer per hour, right? So what we'll do, it is simple. We are given the distances, we have to find the speed, and we know that this time T1, this time T2 will add up to form 3 hours. That is the standard approach for this question. So simply you can say that here the time T1 is going to be distance upon speed, that is 63 upon S hours, because distance is in kilometer, speed is in kilometer per hour, so this value T1 will be in hours. If we talk about T2, that would be simply distance upon speed. The distance in this case is 72 kilometers, and the speed here is S plus 6, and overall we get the value in hours. Now it says this value and this value T1 and T2 will add up to form this T total, which is nothing but 3 hours. So I can write one more equation, and that equation will be T1 plus T2 is equal to 3, or we can substitute the value of T1 as 63 by S plus the value of T2 as 72 upon S plus 6 is equal to 3. This is the equation we have to solve in order to get the value of S. Is the idea clear to you? Right? But let me just go in one step forward direction, not in reality, but in thinking. So sometimes you have to think forward. As we say in Hindi, that you have to 10 कदम आगे का आपको सोचना पड़ता है. सो हियर वी हैव टू थिंक अबाउट द फॉरवर्ड स्टेप्स इवन बिफोर अटेम्प्टिंग दोज स्टेप्स. सो इन ऑर्डर टू सॉल्व दिस पर्टिकुलर इक्वेशन व्हाट यू विल हैव टू डू, यू विल हैव टू टेक द एलसीएम. द एलसीएम विल कम आउट टू बी एस, एस प्लस 6. हियर इट विल बिकम 63 टाइम्स एस प्लस 6. हियर इट विल बिकम 72 टाइम्स एस इज इक्वल टू 3. देन यू विल क्रॉस मल्टीप्लाई दिस वैल्यू हियर एंड अल्टीमेटली as one can observe this s and this s will multiply to form s square. So ultimately this overall equation will become a quadratic equation which would be something like this, s square plus s plus 0 equal to something. This thing, this s square is the term which can bother me, okay, and I do not want to take things in those directions. So is there some another way to actually solve this question further? Yes guys, there is. Now just think that what is the value you want to find. It is the value of s that we want to actually find out, and it is also clear that this s is somewhere in the options also. So the smarter thing to do here is to put one of the values from this these options into this equation. That is the smartest approach you can have in order to solve this question in a quicker way as compared to others who are competing with you. Okay. So just let me take it down and let me write the approach we are going to use forward. So here we will have the equation like this. Now we can put different values of s. We can put s is equal to 24, we can put s is equal to 33, we can put s is equal to 42, and we can put s is equal to 66, right? And one after another we can put different values to get the right answer. But even in this smart approach, the smartest person would be the one who can actually choose the best option out of these and then put it. How can we do that? So just simply observe one thing here. Here we have this term as 63, and this 63 is nothing but a multiple of 21. Similarly, out of all the options, this option C, where speed is equal to 42, this 42 is also a multiple of 21. So let us try putting this value first apart from other options. Okay, that is something a smart approach can help you with. So this is the smart approach I am telling you. Instead of actually solving the equation, we can try the various options given to us, and even in among all the options we can choose the one which can give us a better value here. So simply I will just try with the value of s equal to 42. So let me just write this down in this side of the equation. So we have 63 upon s plus we have 72 upon s plus 6 is equal to 3. If we take this, we will have 63 upon 42 plus 72 upon 42 plus 6 is equal to 3. Here you can have 63 by 42 will be nothing but 3 by 2. Here you will get 72 by 48. You can cancel it out with the factor of 24. And it will also become 3 by 2 equal to 3. So ultimately you get 3 by 2 plus 3 by 2 is equal to 3. If you add both them up, 3 by 2 and 3 by 2 will actually add up to 3, and you will get 3 is equal to 3. What does 3 equal to 3 means? It means that LHS is equal to RHS, and thus the value we put here is actually the correct value. Okay, so simply what we got here, ultimately the thing we got is LHS is equal to RHS, right? So option number C is going to be the correct option in this case. So you can see with smartness we can actually deal with such problems in a much more efficient way, right? So sometimes taking a shortcut might help you a bit. Okay, next. Mr. Kumar drives to work at an average speed of 48 km per hour. The time taken to cover the first 60% of the distance is 10 minutes more than the time taken to cover the remaining distance. Okay, so how far is his office from his home? That is the basic idea of the question. Let me just draw a diagram so that द होल पिक्चर इज क्लियर टू यू. सो लेट मी जस्ट मेक अ रफ डायग्राम. सपोज दिस इज द टोटल डिस्टेंस डी फ्रॉम द होम ऑफ द पर्सन टू द ऑफिस ऑफिस. And now it says that this distance we can separate in two parts. The first 60%. So the 60% of D, you can simply write as we have discussed in percentage topic, it is nothing but 0.6D, right? The remaining distance would be how much? So please enlighten me. So that distance is going to be simply 40%, simply 100 minus 60, that is 40% of D. And that will be equal to 0.4D, right? 0.6D and 0.4D, these are the two parts of this larger distance D. Is it clear to you now? So now it says that suppose the time taken here is T minutes. The time taken for the 60% of the distance will be 10 minutes more as provided in the question. The time here in this case will be T plus 10 minutes. Okay. Now, the question is providing you the average speed. So, the speed here and here will be the same. And the speed here is also 48 kmph. And here it is the same. It is 48 km per hour. Right. So what we'll do next is just write down the speed, distance and time equations for both the cases now. So if we talk about the first case, we will have simply speed is equal to distance upon time. So we will get 48 is equal to 0.6D upon T plus 10, right? And since this time is in minutes, this distance let us assume is in kilometer and this speed is in kilometer per hour. So these minutes we have to convert them into hours by dividing with 60. So please take care of this part. This part is very crucial, dividing it by 60 so that you get the right answer. Why dividing by 60? Because the time we assumed is in minutes. So we have to convert it into hours by dividing with 60. Let us look at the second equation. Here we have speed is equal to distance upon time. Speed is same, the 48. Distance is 0.4D, time taken is now 2 minutes, but we have to divide it by 60 to convert it into hours, correct? So we have these two equations, this one, and we have to just solve these two equations to get the desired value. Now we have two variables, we have time also as a variable and we have distance D also as a variable, but what we are interested in, finding the distance from office, that is the value of D. Is something we are interested to find out. Is it clear? So that is the way we will approach things. And let me just erase it so that we can solve the equations more clearly. So you can observe that a diagram can help a lot in actually solving these questions. I have told you earlier in the previous video also that some topics need diagram. Speed, distance and time is one such topic, right? So we have here the equation is 48 is equal to 0.4D upon T. This 60 will go in the numerator. We can further multiply these values. We will have 48 is equal to, it will become 60 into 0.4 is nothing but 6 into 4, that is equal to 24. So we get 24D upon T. ठीक है? And you can just send this T in cross multiplication, you will get 48 T is equal to 24 D. Okay, this is one equation we are getting. What about the other equation? Let us try to simplify this particular equation. So here we will have 60 coming to the numerator and so we will have 48 is equal to 0.6 D into 60 upon T plus 10. This 60 and this 0.6, this multiplication will be nothing but equal to 6 into 6, which is 36, and therefore we will get 36 D in numerator. What about the denominator? Let us cross multiply this value on the other side. So here you will have 48 times t plus 10 is equal to 36 d. Further, we can write it like this: 48 t plus 480. I am just opening up the bracket by multiplication is equal to 36 d. And further, we can write 48 t is equal to 36 d minus 480. Now we have two equations. Both are having t and d in them, as you can see. But what is the best part now? The best part is that we do not need the value of t. We need only the value of d, the distance we have to find. So in this equation, you can see 48 t, and this value is nothing but equal to 24 d. Here you can also see the 48 t value. What we'll do? We'll just substitute this value of 48 t from here, and we'll get an equation in terms of d only. That is something you can do to get a fast calculation. So from here you get 24 d is equal to 36 d minus 480. Correct? We'll try to solve that equation further. So on the sidelines, I'm going to write it. So ultimately, here you can see 36 d minus 24 d, that will become, and this 480 we can send on the other side, it will become plus 480. Ultimately, it will become 12 d is equal to 480, and ultimately d will be equal to 40. And the answer, since we assume d to be in kilometer, so the final answer will come out to be d is equal to 40 kilometer. That is, option number B is the correct option in this case. So I'm just trying to summarize the whole approach in just, you know, 30 seconds. What we did, we just drew a diagram to understand the scenario. We got two particular cases. For both of them, we write the equations, and just using the two equations, we got the value of d, which comes out to be 40 kilometer. Okay, so it was one more question now. Moving on, this is also a question based on simple speed, distance, and time. So have a look. So a worker is there who reaches his factory 3 minutes late. If his speed from his house to the factory is 5 km/h, but if he walks at a speed of 6 km/h, he reaches the factory 7 minutes early. So the distance of the factory from his house is what? So let me just draw a simple diagram. Here is the house of the worker, and here is the factory of the worker. Let us assume the distance to be d, right? Normally, suppose he goes with some speed, and normal time taken is equal to t. Right? Normal time he is taking is nothing but t, and this time is also in minutes, so t minutes. Now, what if he travels at a speed of 5 km/h? So if he travels at a speed of 5 km/h, in that case the time taken will be how much? T plus 3 minutes. He is taking 3 more minutes. Since he is 3 minutes late, he is taking 3 more minutes than the usual time. So the speed will, the time taken will be t plus 3 minutes. Okay. And the distance to be travelled here is simply d, so nothing to worry about that. Let us focus on the second part. So when the speed is equal to 6 km/h, the time taken is how much? He is reaching 7 minutes early. That means the time taken will be now t minus 7 minutes. The distance is same, still d. So this would be the basic values of speed, time, and distance. Speed, time, and distance. This is all we have figured out using a basic diagram. Correct? Now we'll move on towards writing the equations. So we talk about the first equation. That would be simply speed is nothing but distance upon time. So you can have 5, which is the speed, is equal to distance d, which we assume to be in kilometer, upon time, which is t plus 3. But since it is in minutes, so we divide by 60 to convert it into hours. What about then the second case? The second equation will be 6, the speed is equal to distance d upon time. Now the time is t minus 7, and since it is in minutes, we are converting it into hours by dividing with 60. So these are the two equations which will be very useful in solving the particular question now. Okay, is it clear? So the first part of the question is very simple. Write down the information, write the equations of speed, distance and time. Now the next part is solving these equations. So let us proceed further with that also. So I am just creating some space. All of this information I have discussed already, so we can just get rid of it. Here we can just modify these equations. We will get 5, mistakenly I used a highlighter. So anyways, we have 5 is equal to, just bring this t in the numerator, we have 60d upon t plus 3, right? Cancel out this 5 and 60 here and send this t plus 3 on the other side by cross multiplication. You will get t plus 3 is equal to 12d. Okay, and I can similarly find the second equation in this way. Here I have 6 is equal to d, bring the 60 in the numerator, and in the denominator we have t minus 7. Again, what we will do, we will just cancel out this 6 and this 60 and cross multiply this on the other side. The second equation we are going to get is t minus 7 is equal to 10. Right, so these are the two equations solving which we can get the final answer. Here you can also see there are two variables, t and d. But what is the variable we are interested in finding? We are interested in finding the distance of the factory from the house. So that is, we are interested in finding the value of d, correct? So just modify the equations a little bit so that you can get rid of t. What I will do, I will just try to send this 3 on the other side. I will have simply t is equal to 12d minus 3. From here I will have, I will send this minus 7 to the other side. From here I will have t is equal to 10d plus 7. Since in this equation there is also t and this equation also is having t, so both of these parts will be equal. So one can say that 12d minus 3 is going to be equal to 10d plus 7. Ultimately, you will have from here 12d minus 10d, you will have 2d, and send 3 to the other side, you will have 7 plus 3, that is equal to 10. Ultimately, d will come out to be 5 kilometer. Just cancel out. So the correct answer in this case is option number C, that is 5 kilometers. So is it clear, guys? So these are the three questions based on simple idea of speed is equal to distance upon time. Just take care of calculation, and whatever I have done is the laziest and the best approach you can find, okay, without further calculation. In all other approaches, na, there will be much larger calculation, and I have managed to complete it in this size only, so I think that is an achievement, right? So these are the things you can learn, and actually it will save time for you in your main exam. Okay, so now we will discuss a certain class of questions which are asked once and again. So first such category is boat and stream. The second category is about trains, and the third category is about circular tracks. Okay, in all of them we will use some concepts of relative motion. So let us talk about boat and stream first. So we will be discussing the concept based on the order of the question. So we have first a question based on boats and streams, so we will look into that first. So boat and stream. Suppose there is a river which is flowing in this direction, okay, and obviously since there is gravity, it is not that simple. There is always some slope, and water always flows, down the slope, as you can see from here. And now we have, suppose a boat going on, right? If this boat is going against the direction of the river, then obviously the river will provide him some resistance. Now in this case, the relative speed is velocity of the boat, let's call it VB, minus velocity of the stream, which is nothing but VS. So here we can say the relative speed is going to be VB minus VS, right? This is the case of upstream motion when you are going towards the upper slope in against the flow of the stream. So this is for upstream. So here I can write V up is equal to VB minus VS, correct? Then let's talk about the case of downstream. What will happen in downstream case? In downstream case, the boat will flow in the direction of the flow of water, and here the river will not provide any resistance but will actually support in the motion of the boat. So if the speed of boat is VB, the overall relative speed which we get in this case, and this case since it is going downwards with the slope, this case is called downstream. And here in this case we have V down is equal to VB plus VS, because now the stream is helping the boat in order to travel along the flow. Okay, so is it clear? These are the basic concepts, and depending on these concepts we are going to solve the given question. Now we have a man is taking half time in rowing a certain distance downstream than compared to upstream. So what is happening now? We have a distance d along a river. When we are going in upstream direction, so time taken is what? Let's call it t up. And now when we are going in downstream direction, the time taken is, let's say, t down, right? Now we can have what? We can understand one thing, that since it is taking half time in going downstream as compared to upstream, one can say t down is nothing but half of t up. So as you can see easily, the time taken to come down is very less as compared to the time of going up, because in this case the river is helping you in the flow. Here river is actually resisting you. Nice. So this is the basic information we have to use. Let me write it down on the top. So t down is equal to half t down is equal to half of t up. This is the equation we are going to use. Now moving on further, let us try to write down the things in terms of distance and speed and all. So let us assume what we have to find in this question ultimately. What is the ratio of the speed in still water of the boat to the speed of the current? So what we have to find in this, we have to find the ratio of the speed of men, okay, in riding the boat, in rowing the boat in still water, that is basically the normal speed. We have to find the velocity of boat, that is VB we have to find, and we have to find the ratio with the speed of the current, that is basically the speed of the river. So let's call it VR. So we have to find the ratio of VB is to VR, right? V boat is to velocity of river is something we have to find. Now what we can say is that when the person is going upstream, in this case the distance traveled is equal to d, time taken is equal to t up, right? And finally we can say that the speed here will be VB minus VR, because it is going against the flow. From here one can say t up, so time is nothing but distance upon speed, that is d upon VB minus VR. This is one equation we are getting. Now let us talk about the downstream case. in downstream motion the distance is equal to d and the time taken is equal to t down, and the speed in this case will be addition of both, because now the river is helping him. We will have vb plus vr as the overall speed. So here equation will be t down is equal to distance upon speed, that is vb plus vr. This is the second equation, right? Now what we have to do is that you have to just put these values in this up equation and get the values of, basically we have to find the ratio of vb and vr, right? So if we put the value of t down there and t up there, we can get the ratio of vb and vr. So let us now proceed in that direction only. So we know that t down is half of t up. T down is nothing but d upon vb plus vr is equal to half of t up, which is nothing but d upon vb minus vr, right? Simply we have to just solve the equation to get the ratio. From here just cancel out d from both sides and cross multiply. Send this whole thing on this side and this denominator on the other side, you will get 2 times vb minus vr is equal to vb plus vr, right? You have to just further solve these equations. Two vb minus 2 vr is equal to vb plus vr. Here we will get this, we will bring the vb's on one side. You have 2 vb minus vb is equal to vr. We send this minus 2 vr on the other side, it becomes plus 2 vr. Ultimately you will have vb is equal to 3 times vr. This is the final, you know, information we can extract from all the calculation. Now is it what you have to find? Yes, but in some different format. So we do not have to find vb equal to v, 3 times vr. We have to find the ratio, and I told you one day that ratio is nothing but fraction. So in order to find vb is to vr, we have to just find vb upon vr, okay? So that would be nothing but vb upon vr. From that equation, if you send this vr in the denominator down below, you get simply the value as 3. So one can say the ratio of vb and vr, the answer is simply 3:1. So the correct option will be option number D, 3:1. Okay, please do not do the mistake of reversing the order. If you reverse the order of b and r, you will get the wrong answer, which is 1:3. Okay, so please be careful, and therefore option number D is the correct option in this case, that is 3:1. Okay, moving on. So this question is based on the concept of train. So let me just give you the basics. Suppose it is a railway track, and on the side of a railway track a man is standing, okay, and there is a train of length L moving with the speed of S. Now it is being asked, in how much time will the train will cross this particular man? So suppose the train is standing here now, or it is in this position. When it completely crosses the person, it is moving in this direction. When it completely crosses this person, its final position will be something like this. You agree or not? So I am drawn the initial position in red color and the final position in yellow color. This distance is at this position now. After completely crossing, the rear part of the train will be in line with the man. Initially the front part is in touch with the man. Now after crossing, the rear part, the back part will be in touch with the man. So if we talk about the first part now, it has actually covered a distance equal to the length of the train itself. Okay, so in this case distance is nothing but the length of the train. Speed we know, and we have to find the time in which the train will cross this particular man. So the time will be nothing but distance upon speed, that is L upon S. Okay, this is the time. Length of the train divided by speed of the train is the time taken to cross any point object. Now pay attention, it is not just a man, but instead of a man, there could have been a pole, a tree, or anything which is just of one point size, okay, which does not have any length. So the formula for any crossing any point sized object which is not having any length is simply length of the train upon the speed of the train, right. Now after that, let us take another case when the train has to cross a length object. So suppose this is a platform. Here we have a railway track, and using blue color I am showing a train. So this train is here, its length is L1, this platform is there, its length is L2, and now this train has to cross this particular platform. So in the initial position, the front part of the train will be in touch with this side of the platform. When this particular train moves forward and crosses the platform, the position in which it would have crossed the platform would be like this, where the back part of the train will be in a single line with this end of the platform. That is the case, right? So that is the condition when this train has actually crossed the platform. Now if we talk about how much distance it had to travel, you can just simply compare the rear parts. Now the rear part was initially at this position, it is L1 plus this L2 distance, and now after complete crossing it, the rear part, the back part, is at this position. So the train has to effectively cover a distance of L1 plus L2, that is length of the train plus length of the platform, and therefore the total distance would be L1 plus L2. Time taken is something we have to find, and the speed of the train is S. So one can simply say that time of crossing this platform will be L1 plus L2 upon S, where L1 is the length of the train and L2 is the length of the platform. Now one thing, apart from a platform, it is also applicable on objects which have a length, such as time taken to cross a bridge or a tunnel or even a stationary train. Stationary train means a train which is not moving, it is just standing there. So it is just simply a length object like a platform. Okay, so that was the basics, and now we will solve the question. I think it is pretty easy. So a train is 200 meters long and it is moving at the rate of 40 kilometer per hour. In how many seconds will it cross a man standing near the railway line? So man is there, it is a what? A point object. So we will just simply use the formula we saw earlier. The time is nothing but distance upon speed. Distance is equal to the length of the train, and so length of the train is given, it is 200 meters. What is the speed of the train? The speed of the train is 40 kilometer per hour. But don't you sense something is faulty? Yeah, there is. So those who have actually figured out that this distance or this speed is in kilometer per hour, and they might be thinking, okay, just multiply it with 5/18 so that it becomes meters per second. So what the time will be now? 200 meters upon 40 into 5. I am sending this 18 in the numerator, and the speed will be now in meters per second instead of kilometer per hour. So that is one correction you have to make. When you cancel all of it out, the values will be cancelled, and you get time is equal to 18 seconds. So, option number D is the correct option in this case, okay. Okay, so after it, we'll move on to the next category of questions, that is circular tracks. Okay, what is circular tracks? So suppose you might have seen some parks. There are a lot of parks in Delhi which are circular in shape, and what people do is that sometimes they are having a walk along the circumference of the park,
So there are proper pavements made for it.
Sometimes there are circular tracks for people to actually have a race, right? So there are circular tracks for racing purposes also. So what kind of questions you are going to see in speed, distance and time would be simply, let me just show to you. So suppose there would be one case in which there will be two persons A and B. So let me just use the bigger alphabets, capital A and capital B. We have capital A and capital B as two people who are running along the circular track. The speed of capital A person is small a, and the capital B person is speed is small b. So both of these are speeds, right? Now what we have to do is that just understand some more details about this circular path. So let us assume the length of the circular path, the whole circumference from here to here, is nothing but equal to L. Now there will be two cases. In case one, both A and B are moving in same direction. So A is moving in this direction, B is also moving in this direction. And now the question can be asked that after what time they will meet with each other. So the time of meeting when both are moving in the same direction can be found out using the concept of relative motion. For that, what we will do, we will just simply assume this person B to be at rest. If person B is at rest and they are also moving in the same direction, the relative velocity in this case will be A minus B, right? A minus B, same direction motion is there. And the distance we calculated as the length L. So time will be simply distance upon speed, and that would be distance we found out as L, and the relative speed coming out to be A minus B. So when both of them are running in the same direction, the time of meeting, T meet, is actually L upon A minus B for same direction. The another case, let's call it case 2, is of opposite direction. So let us talk about that also. When they are running in opposite direction, so if A is going that way in the counterclockwise direction, then B will be running in clockwise direction this way, right? Now here we can say the time of meeting will be simply distance upon speed. Distance as usual again is equal to the length L. But what about the relative speed now in this case? In this case, since they are running in opposite directions, the relative speed will be simply not A minus B, but it will become A plus B. And now you can write the speed as A plus B. So ultimately, if they are running in opposite directions, the time of meeting would be L upon A plus B, right? That is the second equation, and both are the cases we are going to see. We'll see one problem for the same direction motion and one problem for the opposite direction motion. Okay, so let's begin the discussion now. In this question 6, we have A and B walk around a circular park. They start at 8 a.m. from the same point in the opposite direction. Okay, A and B walk at the speed of 2 rounds per hour and three rounds per hour respectively. Then how many times shall they cross each other after 8 p.m. and before 9:30 a.m.? So let me just tell you the premise of the question. Here we have a circular park. Here we are not given any detail of the length of the circular park, and we have A and B which are actually moving in opposite directions. The speed of A is given out to be 2 rounds per hour, and the speed of B is coming out to be 3 rounds per hour. Right? So it is not even giving you the speed in terms of meters per second or kilometer per hour. Instead, it is giving you the speed in terms of rounds per hour. Okay? And now that is the tricky part. So let us just follow one very good trick which can help you to actually ease out the calculation of this particular question in a very easy manner. Okay? Since the length of this circular track is not given to me, I can try to assume some length. So now people assume different kind of length. You can assume the length of the track to be 100 meter, 1000 meter, 10,000 meter, anything. But I am going to choose the value of 3600 meter. This is the length of the track which I am going to choose. Now you might be having the question, why 3600? That is something you will learn in the due course of time. Just give me a minute and it will be all an open secret in front of your eyes. So if A is traveling at a speed of 2 rounds per hour, what is the total distance? One round is 3600 meter. So 2 rounds will be 2 into 3600 meter. Right? What about hours? 1 hour. But now we want the speed in meters per second. So you know 1 hour as 60 into 60, that is 3600 seconds, right? And now you can see, I can just cancel out 3600 and 3600 to get 2 meters per second, a very nice value for the speed of A. Similarly, down there for B, we can say that 3 into 3600 meter, which we assume the length of one round, divided by 3600 seconds, cancelling them out, we get the velocity of person B as simply 3 meters per second. And that is why, guys, I chose the value of L to be 3600. If I would have chosen any different value, you might have got the things in terms of fractions. And nobody likes that. I know that. Okay, so I am just getting these very nice and sweet values for velocity of A and velocity of B. Now, simply we have L in our case, that is 3600. We have velocity of A as 2 meters per second, velocity of B as 3 meters per second. Now, we have to find the time in which they meet. Since they are moving in opposite direction, this time of meeting is going to be L upon A plus B, that is 3600 upon 2 plus 3 divided by 5. When we cancel out, we get the value of meeting time as 720 seconds. So they will meet one another in 720 seconds. So now let us try to simplify this value. Instead of 720 seconds, let us divide it by 60, and you will get, I think, 12 minutes as the time of their meeting. So they meet in one round, in one time they meet at 12 minutes, right? Now, what is the next part of the question? The question says, if they are starting it at 8 a.m. and they are ending it at 9:30 a.m., so in the given duration of 1.5 hours, so as you know, from 8 a.m. to 9:30 a.m., it is a duration of 1.5 hours. And 1.5 hours is nothing but 1.5 into 60, that is 90 minutes. So in 90 minutes time duration, how many times will they actually meet? So time for first meeting or one meeting is 12 minutes, and overall they have 90 minutes time. So the number of times they meet will be simply the total time from 8 a.m. to 9:30 a.m., that is 90 minutes of time, divided by the time taken to meet after one, you know, after meeting the first time, and after that they will keep meeting in 12 minutes duration.
So in 12 minutes. So just divide the values, you will get 7.5, I guess, as the
number of times. So since they are meeting in the number will be in integer form only, na? So actually they meet 7 times. Okay, just take the front part of it, you get 7. So 7 times they are able to meet. Okay, if time duration would have been more, then they could have met one more time, 8 times. But now, since the time duration is there, 9:30 time limit is there, they will be able to meet only 7 times, and therefore option number A is going to be the correct option in this case. Okay, so that was it. This was a question of opposite direction motion, and now we have one more question of same direction motion. Let us look at that also. So X and Y are running a 3-kilometer race along a circular course of length 300 meter. Their speeds are in the ratio 3:2. So if they start together in the same direction, how many times would the first one pass the other? So how many times they will cross each other? That is the same thing which is being asked, as being asked in the previous year question, previous question. Okay, so here you can see the length is given to you in this case, which is 300 meter, but speeds are not given. So it says A and B are in the ratio of 3:2. Let us take the simplest value of all, guys. Instead of any other value, just take the value of 3 meters per second and 2 meters per second, let's say, right? Now they have to run a total race of 3 kilometers, or you can also write it in meters, that is 3000 meters. The total race they have to run is of 3000 meters. Now let us try to find out the time in which they will meet. First part, let us try to find out the time in which they will meet. Since they are in the same direction, the time of meeting will be L upon A minus B. L is 300 meter. You have 3 minus 2, that is 300 seconds will be the time of meeting. So they will meet, or they will cross each other after every 300 seconds, right? Now the another part of the question is, what is the total time duration? So they are meeting after every 300 seconds, but earlier it provided you the time limit, that okay, from 8 a.m. to 9:30 a.m. That is the time duration for which they are running. Here no such time duration is being provided, but one information is being given which can help you actually to find out the time duration. It has given you the total distance as 3 kilometer. Total 3 kilometer race they are running, right? And now if they are running this race of 3 kilometer or 3000 meters, what will be the total time of the race? That is the next interesting part. Total time of race. So the race will end as soon as the faster guy, the guy with 3 meter per second speed, will cross the finish line. Okay, isn't that simple? It is very simple, but it is also very tricky to think at the exam time. Okay, so if you want to find the total time duration in which they will meet, previously it was given to you from 8 to 9:30. Here you have to actually figure it out by finding the total time of the race, and the total time of the race is nothing but total distance, which is 3000 meter, divided by the faster version, the faster guy, that is 3 meters per second speed, and now the time taken for the race will be 1000 seconds. Is it clear now? So the race will finish in 1000 seconds, and how many in how much time they meet each other? 300 seconds. So if you want to find the number of times they meet, so like in previous question, what we did, we divided the overall time divided by the meeting time. So the number of time of meeting is actually equal to 1000 divided by 300, that is 10 by 3, will get somewhat the value equal to 3.333. You have to just take the front part of it. That would mean they will meet 3 times. Had the time been given more, or the distance would have been more, they might have met one more time also, but now they are meeting only 3 times. So the correct option in this case is going to be option number B, that is 3. right? Now this is the second last question of this particular topic. So a daily train, and in this question, mind you, these are miscellaneous questions. This question and the last question, these questions are miscellaneous questions because you know they are not actually following any pattern, any formula, nothing. They are just using some amount of common sense that we require to solve these questions. Okay, so let me give it a read. A daily train is to be introduced between station A and station B, starting from each end at 6 a.m. and the journey is to be completed in 42 hours. What is the number of train needed in order to maintain this particular service? Suppose we have a station A and we have a station B, right? And we have to start a train service. So every day at 6 a.m. one train should leave from here. So let's call it the first train. It is leaving from the station A at 6 a.m. Okay, and since it is talking about train starting from each end, from this side also a train will start at 6 a.m. Another train, let's call it train 2, will start from the other side. Okay, but the problem is the total journey time from A to B is actually 42 hours. So this journey cannot be completed in one single day. Okay, after 24 hours this train 1 would be somewhere in between at this position and it will reach the other point at the next day. Okay, so the issue is there. Similarly, this train will also not be able to reach the station on time. It will somewhere in between and it will reach on the station A on the next day. But you have to pay attention, you have to use the trains daily. There must be daily services available for the trains. So after this train has gone, on the next day, so if this is day 1, let's call it day 1, from here on day 1 this train is going on and here on day 1 this train is going on. So on day 2 you will have to start a third train which will go in the same direction. It will start at 6 a.m. same, and this train will reach the other side, this will reach in between, then this train will reach here, it will go back. So the same scenario is there. Similarly, from that side also we will start a train at 6 a.m. on day 2. And so now the thing is complete. When this train will reach here, this train will be in between and this train might have reached at this point. So the next day this train will go that way, this train will start returning and the train in between will reach on the other destination. So now if 4 trains are there overall, the daily service can be provided with total ease. So this question did not require any basic of speed, distance and time. It required just simple common sense to find out that overall 1, 2, 3 and 4 trains will be required. That is option number C is correct. And this is a common sense based question. There are services apart from IAS and IPS in UPSC such as IRMS or IRTS. So in those services, I am not saying that this is the work you have to do, but kind of similar thing, right? So a different category of question is being asked here, not using any equation but just pure common sense. So it is a miscellaneous question in that way, right? Now we look at the last question of the day now. Okay, so this is the last question of the topic and this is also a miscellaneous question now. So let me read it. 4 cars are hired at a rate of rupees 6 per kilometer and the cost of diesel is at rupees 40 per liter, right? And now few more details are given. So 4 cars are there, A, B, C and D. Their mileages are given at 10, 9 and 11. The hours for which they are hired, the hours for which they are moving is given to be 20, 25, 24 and 22. And the total bill or the total payment each car, had to do was this much. This is the information provided to you. And based on this information, the thing being asked is, which car had the maximum average speed? Maximum average speed is being asked. So now this question seems like, what is happening here, guys? What is happening? I just get confused, so much of information, but in the end average speed, how do we do that? So this question is quite miscellaneous in its approach. Okay, the concept of speed, distance and time is not that useful as regards other concepts. So let us try to figure out whatever is the information provided to us. First, let us talk about the cost part of it, the payment part of it, right? This payment part. So here the cost can arise from two reasons. The first reason is 6 rupees per kilometer is the charge. So whatever distance it is traveling, into the charge, that is rupees 6 per kilometer, that is one cost, right? What is the another cost? Another cost is cost of the fuel, and the cost of fuel is nothing but, let me use a different color to express it. So the cost of fuel is rupees 40 per liter. So you can write nothing but fuel consumed into the rate of rupees 40 per liter. So this is the total cost from the distance and from the fuel which is being consumed. Now, does the question provides any information regarding the distance traveled?
No.
So let us try to assume the distance traveled by them. Let us assume the distance by A is simply small a, small b, small c and small d. These are the distances traveled by them. Okay. After that, let us talk about the fuel consumed. How much fuel is consumed? There is some information which can help to tell the final thing, that is the mileage. If we have the mileage, we can actually find out the fuel consumed. So what mileage basically is? Mileage is basically the distance traveled upon the fuel which is consumed. So mileage is nothing but distance upon fuel. Okay. So if I am saying that mileage is nothing but distance upon fuel, I can say fuel consumed is nothing but distance upon mileage, right? What is the distance traveled by each of them, A, B, C and D? Just we assume the values. And what are the mileages? Mileages are given. So this part, fuel consumed, can also be represented in the form of mileage divided, distance divided by mileage. Okay, so we will try to write down these values basically in terms of distance, that is simply distance into the charge per kilometer. Then here we have distance divided by mileage. The fuel consumed is nothing but distance divided by mileage into rupees 40 per liter. That would be the approach, and using this approach we can actually find out the distances traveled, because we have the total cost in each case, we have the different parts of how the cost is built up. And using that information, we can find the distance each car has traveled. But now the next part remains, how do we find the average speed of each car? For that, you know, you have the distance A, B, C and D that you can find using those equations. After that, you have the time also in hours, that is 20 hour, 25 hour, 24 hour and 22 hours. Using the information of time, you can actually find out what? The average speed also. That will be the process we are going to follow. We will just find out the, you know, distance using the total cost, and distance divided by this time will be the average speed. Okay, that is the process we have to follow. Now we will go on the calculations, and one after another we will actually find out the average speeds. So let us talk about A first. When we talk about A, what is the information being given? So for car A, mileage is equal to 8 kilometer per liter, right? And total cost came out to be around 2120 rupees. So as we can know that total cost is nothing but the distance traveled by car A into rupees 6 per kilometer plus the fuel consumed. How much fuel is consumed? Distance divided by mileage. Distance is A, mileage is 8, into the cost of petrol is rupees 40. This is the total cost, and it is equal to nothing but 2120. So simply we will have an equation of 6A
plus, cancel out this, it will go 5 times. 5a is equal to 2120. We will have 11a equal to 2120, or a is nothing but 2120 upon 11. This will be the distance being travelled by car A. Now, is that it? No, we are not interested in the distance travelled by car A. We are interested in the average speed of car A. And what is the average speed going to be? Just divide the distance by the time taken, and for car A, time is 20 hours. And so, we can find out the speed of A, let us call it VA, coming out to be 2120 upon 11, that is the distance, divided by time, that would be 20 hours. So, overall you will get the value, it will come around to be somewhere 9.63 kilometer per hour. So, here you can see the calculation is not very good. The calculation part here are fractions, decimals, the calculation is very ugly, I tell you. Okay. So, ultimately we know that the average speed of A is coming out to be 9.63. So, I will simply write the average speed of A, just let me erase all of it and simply write the average speed of A, let us call it VA, is coming out to be 9.63 kilometer per hour. Okay. Let us talk about car B now. Okay, so now we will complete car B, C and D all together. We will not wait much because the process is the same for all of them. For car B, we have, you know, mileage is equal to how much? I guess 10. Here the mileage is 9. Here the mileage is 11. What about the total cost? It is 1950 in this case. Here we have 2064, and finally we have cost as equal to 1812. And what is the time taken? Time taken here is 25 hours, 24 hours, and 22 hours. Okay, this is the information being provided. Using this information, we can say that distance by B, that is B, into cost per kilometer, that is 6 rupees. So, we have 6B plus the fuel consumed, that is nothing but distance upon mileage, that is B by 10, into the cost of petrol, that is 40, is equal to the total cost, which is 1950. Similarly, here we will have 6C plus C upon 9, here the mileage is 9, into 40 is equal to 2064. And finally, we will have here 6D plus D by 11, the mileage is 11, into 40 is equal to 1812. Using all these informations, we will get the value of distances travelled, we will get the value of B, the value of C and the value of D. But that would not be the final value. We will be more interested in the values of the speeds. So, speed of B is going to be nothing but B upon 25 hour. So, you get speed in kilometer per hour. For C, the speed is coming out to be C upon 24 hour. And for D, the speed is coming out to be how much? It is coming out to be D upon 22 hours. So, B is nothing but D upon 22 hours, right? So, the calculation is going to be very nasty for this particular question, okay? So, I am just telling you the final answers, what will be the final values. So, for VB, you will get the value as somewhere around 7.8 kilometer per hour. For VC, you will get the values to be around 8.23 kilometer per hour. And for VD, you will get the speeds to be somewhat around 8.54 kilometer per hour. As we can see, the maximum of all the four speed is nothing but
the speed of A, which is 9.63. So the correct option is going to be option number A, that is car A. Is it correct? So this was such a question which, you know, I would advise you not to attempt and not to waste time on during the exam. Okay? There are some battles which you should have to leave in order to win the bigger battle. So you might be aware of the story in which Lord Krishna actually evaded a battle which was fought against Jarasandha, I think, and due to that he was called as Ranchhor. But sometimes it is wiser to leave a battle than to win and, you know, get embroiled into it. So finally we have the most important slide, thanking you guys for your support and for your patience, and I hope this particular session would be very useful to you. Thank you so much.